Hi, and welcome to Lecture 5, which is titled Grounding Infrastructure for Cabling. In this lecture, we'll review standards-based guidelines and components for telecommunications grounding within commercial buildings. It should be noted that all recommendations for grounding presented here are performance-related. They're intended to support error-free operations of network equipment. They do not replace the safety-related requirements specified in electrical and building codes. The ANSI TIA 607-D standard specifies the bonding and grounding requirements for optimal signal transmission over copper cabling systems. The primary goal is to make sure there are no differences in potential between the electrical and telecommunications grounding systems, since all powered network devices are connected to both. One of the recommendations is to keep grounding and bonding conductors, like the ones shown here, as short as possible to minimize impedance, which increases with conductor length. Another recommendation is to make sure all grounding-related products are correctly installed. For example, painted surfaces on a rack or cabinet must be scraped free to ensure metal-to-metal contact prior to the fastening of a bonding conductor. And the last three items on this list are quantitative values that can be verified by installers or technicians to confirm the effectiveness of the telecommunications grounding infrastructure in place, as follows. The maximum resistance of the building's grounding electrode system is 25 ohms. The maximum resistance between the telecommunications grounding system and the electrical grounding system is 100 milliohms, or 1/10 of an ohm. And if the network cabling system is shielded, the maximum potential between a cable shield or a shielded equipment outlet and the grounding contact of a nearby electrical receptacle is 1 volt. Next, we'll review the standards-based terminology for grounding components. We begin with the primary bonding busbar, or PBB, which is an extension of the building grounding electrode system dedicated to the network cabling infrastructure. This component was identified in the past as the TMGB, or Telecommunications Main Grounding Busbar. It should be noted that the TIA changed most of the component names in 2015 in order to harmonize its terminology with the ISO IEC 30129 International Standard for Telecommunications Bonding. In this schematic illustration of a building's telecommunications grounding infrastructure, the PBB is located in the distributor room housing the building distributor, close to the grounding electrode system terminated in the electrical entrance facility. The conductor that bonds the PBB to the building's grounding electrode system is called the telecommunications bonding conductor, or TBC. And here's the TBC connecting the primary bonding busbar to the building's grounding electrode system terminated in the adjacent electrical entrance space. The secondary bonding busbar, or SBB, is a smaller version of the PBB. Previously called the Telecommunications Grounding Busbar, or TGB, it's found in every distributor room housing a floor distributor within the building. And here are the secondary bonding busbars in each of the distributor rooms housing floor distributors within the building. The Telecommunications Bonding Backbone, or TBB, is a cable used to connect one or more secondary bonding busbars to the building's primary bonding busbar. And here are the telecommunications bonding backbones linking each of the SBBs to the PBB. The backbone bonding conductor, or BBC, is a conductor used to interconnect telecommunications bonding backbone cables in order to equalize any potential differences between the distributor rooms containing secondary bonding busbars. And here's the BBC on the top floor, linking the two telecommunications bonding backbone cables running vertically to the primary bonding busbar on the ground floor. Our final term is the rack bonding busbar, or RBB, which serves as a common grounding point for all mounted items, such as network equipment or shielded patch panels, on an open rack or in an enclosed cabinet within a distributor room. And here are two examples of RBBs, one mounted vertically and the other horizontally. The vertical mount RBB shown on the left has a higher cost due to its longer length, but there's a benefit in the form of shorter and uniform lengths for the individual or unit bonding conductors. If there are fewer devices expected to be placed in the rack or cabinet, it may be more advantageous to go with the horizontal mount RBB shown on the right, since there will be a small number of unit bonding conductors. This brings us to the end of Lecture 5, titled Grounding Infrastructure for Cabling. Thank you for watching.